The Graveyard Book by Neil Gaiman. Greetings, friends, and thanks for joining us for another episode of our Tween Storytime with AHMFL. Now, last time, we read the first half of Chapter 1 of Neil Gaiman's The Graveyard Book. We met a toddler whose family had just been killed by the man Jack, but the toddler luckily wandered away up the hill to a local graveyard, where he was discovered by some friendly ghosts, Mr. and Mrs. Owens. When we stopped reading, the man Jack has just tracked the toddler to the graveyard, and the Owens were making a big decision. Was the toddler going to stay with them in the graveyard, or was the man Jack going to get him? Let's see what happens in Chapter 1, Part 2 of Neil Gaiman's The Graveyard Book. "And you, Owens, will you be a father to this little lad?"
"Will I what?"
said Owens, his brow crinkling. "We never had a child," said his wife, "and his mother wants us to protect him. Will you say yes?" The man in the black coat had tripped in the tangle of ivy and broken headstones. Now he got to his feet and walked forward more carefully, startling an owl which rose on silent wings. He could see the baby, and there was triumph in his eyes. Owens knew what his wife was thinking when she used that tone of voice. They had not, in life and in death, been married for over 250 years for nothing.
"Are you certain?" he asked. "Are you sure?"
"Sure as I've ever been of anything," said Mrs. Owens.
"Then yes, if you'll be its mother, I'll be its father."
"Did you hear that?" Mrs. Owens asked the flickering shape in the graveyard, now little more than an outline, like distant summer lightning in the shape of a woman.
It said something to her that no one else could hear, and then it was gone.
"She'll not come here again," said Mr. Owens. "Next time she wakes, it'll be in her own graveyard, or wherever it is she's going."
Mrs. Owens bent down to the baby and extended her arms.
"Come now," she said warmly. "Come to Mama."
To the man, Jack, walking through the graveyard towards them on a path, his knife already in his hand, it seemed as if a swirl of mist had curled around the child in the moonlight, and that the boy was no longer there, just damp mist and moonlight and swaying grass. He blinked and sniffed the air. Something had happened, but he had no idea what it was. He growled in the back of his throat like a beast of prey, angry and frustrated.
"Hello?" called the man Jack.
Wondering if perhaps the child had stepped behind something, his voice was dark and rough, and there was an odd edge to it, as if of surprise or puzzlement at hearing himself speak. The graveyard kept its secrets.
"Hello?"
he called again. He hoped to hear a baby cry or utter a half word, or to hear it move. He did not expect what he actually heard, a voice silky smooth, saying,
"Can I help you?"
The man Jack was tall. This man was taller. The man Jack wore dark clothes. This man's clothes were darker. People who noticed the man Jack when he was about his business, and he did not like to be noticed, were troubled or made uncomfortable, or found themselves unaccountably scared. The man Jack looked up at the stranger, and it was the man Jack who was troubled.
"I was looking for someone,"
said the man Jack, slipping his right hand back into his coat pocket, so the knife was hidden, but there if he needed it.
"In a locked graveyard at night?"
said the stranger.
"It was just a baby," said the man Jack. "I was passing when I heard a baby cry, and I looked through the gates and I saw him. Well, what would anyone do?"
"I applaud your public spiritedness," said the stranger. "Yet, if you manage to find this child, how are you planning to get out of here with it? You can't climb back over the wall holding a baby."
"I would have called until someone let me out," said the man Jack.
A heavy jingling of keys.
"Well, that would have been me then," said the stranger. I would have had to let you out. He selected one large key from the key ring and said, Follow me. The man Jack walked behind the stranger. He took his knife from his pocket.
Are you the caretaker, then?
Am I? Certainly in a manner of speaking, said the stranger. They were walking toward the gates, and the man, Jack was certain, away from the baby. But the caretaker had the keys. A knife in the dark, that was all it would take, and then he could search for the child all through the night if he needed to. He raised the knife. If there was a baby, said the stranger, without looking back, it wouldn't have been here in the graveyard. Perhaps you are mistaken. It's unlikely that a child would have come in here after all. Much more likely that you heard a nightbird and saw a cat, perhaps, or a fox. They declared this place an official nature reserve, you know, 30 years ago, around the time of the last funeral. Now think carefully and tell me you are certain that it was a child that you saw. The man Jack thought. The stranger unlocked the side gate. A fox, he said. They make the most uncommon noises, not unlike a person crying. No, your visit to this graveyard was a misstep, sir. Somewhere the child you seek awaits you, but he is not here. And he let the thought sit there in the man Jack's head for a moment, before he opened the gate with a flourish. Delighted to have made your acquaintance, he said, and I trust that you will find everything you need out there. The man Jack stood outside the gates to the graveyard. The stranger stood inside the gate, and he locked it again, and put the key away.
"Where are you going?" asked the man Jack.
"There are other gates than this," said the stranger. "My car is on the other side of the hill. Don't mind me. You don't even have to remember this conversation."
"No," said the man Jack. "I don't."
He remembered wandering up the hill, that what he had thought to be a child had turned out to be a fox, that a helpful caretaker had escorted him back to the street. He slipped his knife into its inner sheath.
"Well," he said, "good night."
"A good night to you," said the stranger, whom Jack had taken for a caretaker. The man Jack set off down the hill in pursuit of the infant. From the shadows, the stranger watched Jack until he was out of sight. Then he moved through the night, up and up, to the flat place below the brow of the hill, a place dominated by an obelisk and a flat stone set into the ground dedicated to the memory of Josiah Worthington, local brewer, politician, and later baronet, who had almost 300 years before bought the old cemetery and the land around it and given it to the city in perpetuity. He had reserved for himself the best location on the hill, a natural amphitheater with a view of the whole city and beyond, and had ensured that the graveyard endured as a graveyard, for which the inhabitants of the graveyard were grateful, although never quite as grateful as Josiah Worthington, Baronet, felt they should have been. There were, all told, some 10,000 souls in the graveyard, but most of them slept deep, or took no interest in the night-to-night affairs of the place, and there were less than 300 of them up there in the amphitheater in the moonlight. The stranger reached them as silently as the fog itself, and he watched the proceedings unfold from the shadows, and he said nothing. Josiah Worthington was speaking. He said,
"My dear madam, your obduracy is, well, can't you see how ridiculous this is?"
"No," said Mrs. Owens, "I can't." She was sitting cross-legged on the ground, and the living child was sleeping in her lap. She cradled its head with her pale hands.
"What Mistress Owens is trying to say, sir, begging your honor's pardon," said Mr. Owens, standing beside her, "is that she doesn't see it that way. She sees it as doing her duty."
Mr. Owens had seen Josiah Worthington in the flesh back when they were both alive, had in fact made several pieces of fine furniture for the Worthington Manor House out near Inglesham, and was still in awe of him.
"Her duty?"
Josiah Worthington, Baronet, shook his head as if to dislodge a strand of cobweb.
"Your duty, ma'am, is to the graveyard and to the commonality of those who form this population of discarnate spirits, revenants, and such like wights. and your duty, thus, is to return the creature as soon as possible to its natural home, which is not here."
"His mama gave the boy to me," said Mrs. Owens, as if that was all that needed to be said.
"My dear woman!"
"I am not your dear woman," said Mrs. Owens, getting to her feet. "Truth to tell, I don't even see why I am here, talking to you fiddle-pated old dunderheads, when this lad is going to wake up hungry soon enough. And where am I going to find food for him in this graveyard, I should like to know?"
"Which," said Caius Pompeius stiffly, "is precisely the point. What will you feed him? How can you care for him?"
Mrs. Owens' eyes burned.
"I can look after him," she said, "as well as his own mamma. She already gave him to me. Look, I'm holding him, aren't I? I'm touching him."
"Now see reason, Betsy," said Mother Slaughter, a tiny old thing in the huge bonnet and cape that she had worn in life and been buried wearing. "Where would he live?"
"Here," said Mrs. Owens. "We could give him the freedom of the graveyard."
Mother Slaughter's mouth became a tiny O.
"But," she said. Then she said, "But I never."
"Well, why not? It ain't the first time we've given the freedom of the graveyard to an outsider."
"That is true," said Caius Pompeius. "But he wasn't alive." And with that, the stranger realized that he was being drawn, like it or not, into the conversation, and reluctantly he stepped out of the shadows, detaching from them like a patch of darkness.
"No," he agreed, "I am not, but I take Mrs. Owens' point."
Josiah Worthington said,
"You do, Silas!"
"I do, for good or for evil, and I firmly believe that it is for good. Mrs. Owens and her husband have taken this child under their protection. It is going to take more than just a couple of good-hearted souls to raise this child. It will," said Silas, "take a graveyard."
"And what of food and the rest of it?"
"I can leave the graveyard and return. I can bring him food," said Silas.
"That's all very well, you saying that," said Mother Slaughter. "But you comes and you goes, and nobody keeps track of you. If you went off for a week, the boy would die."
"You are a wise woman," said Silas. "I see why they speak so highly of you."
He couldn't push the minds of the dead as he could the living, but he could use all of the tools of flattery and persuasion he possessed, for the dead were not immune to either. Then he came to a decision.
"Very well. If Mr. and Mrs. Owens will be his parents, I shall be his guardian. I shall remain here, and if I need to leave, I shall ensure that someone takes my place, bringing the child food and looking after him. We can use the crypt of the chapel," he added.
"But," expostulated Josiah Worthington, "but a human child, a living child, I mean, this is a graveyard, not a nursery, blast it!"
"Exactly," said Silas, nodding. "A very good point, Sir Josiah. I couldn't have put it better myself. And for that reason, if for no other, it is vital that the child be raised with as little disruption as possible to the, if you'll forgive the expression, the life of the graveyard."
With that, he strolled over to Mrs. Owens, and he looked down at the infant asleep in her arms. He raised an eyebrow.
"Does he have a name, Mrs. Owens?"
"Not that his mother told me," she said.
"Well, then," said Silas, "his old name won't be of much use to him now, anyway. There are those out there who mean him harm. Suppose we pick a name for him, eh?"
Caius Pompeius stepped over and eyed the child.
"He looks a little like my proconsul, Marcus. We could call him Marcus."
Josiah Worthington said,
"He looks more like my head gardener, Stebbins. Not that I'm suggesting Stebbins as a name. The man drank like a fish."
"He looks like my nephew, Harry,"
said Mother Slaughter. And it seemed then as if the whole graveyard was about to join in, each inhabitant offering his or her own comparisons between the infant and someone long forgotten, when Mrs. Owens broke in.
"He looks like nobody but himself,"
said Mrs. Owens firmly.
"He looks like nobody."
"Then nobody it is," said Silas. "Nobody Owens."
It was then that, as if responding to the name, the child opened its eyes wide in wakefulness. It stared around it, taking in the faces of the dead, and the mist, and the moon. Then it looked at Silas. Its gaze did not flinch. It looked grave.
"What kind of a name is Nobody?" asked Mother Slaughter, scandalized.
"His name, and a good one," Silas told her. "It will help to keep him safe."
"I don't want trouble," said Josiah Worthington.
The infant looked up at him, and then, hungry or tired or simply missing his home, his family, his world, he screwed up his tiny face and began to cry.
"Leave us," said Caius Pompeius to Mrs. Owens. "We will discuss this further without you."
Mrs. Owens waited outside the funeral chapel. It had been decreed over 40 years before that the building, in appearance of a small church with a spire, was a listed building of historical interest. The town council had decided that it would cost too much to renovate it, a little chapel in an overgrown graveyard that had already become unfashionable, so they had padlocked it and waited for it to fall down. Ivy covered it, but it was solidly built, and it would not fall down this century. The child had fallen asleep in Mrs. Owen's arms. She rocked it gently, sang to it an old song, one her mother had sung to her when she was a baby herself, back in the days when men had first started to wear powdered wigs. The song went, "Sleep, my little baby, oh, sleep until you waken. When you're grown, you'll see the world, if I'm not mistaken. Kiss a lover, dance a measure, find your name and bury treasure." And Mrs. Owen sang all that before she discovered that she had forgotten how the song ended. She had a feeling that the final line was something in the way of, "and some hairy bacon," but that might have been another song altogether. So she stopped, and instead she sang him the one about the man in the moon who came down too soon. And after that she sang, in her warm country voice, a more recent song about a lad who had put in his thumb and pulled out a plum. And she had just started to sing a long ballad about a young country gentleman whose girlfriend had, for no particular reason, poisoned him with a dish of spotted eels, when Silas came around the side of the building, carrying a cardboard box.
"Here we go, Mistress Owens," he said. "Lots of good things for a growing boy. We can keep it in the crypt, eh?"
The padlock fell off in his hand, and he pulled open the iron door. Mrs. Owens walked inside, looking dubiously at the shelves and at the old wooden pews tipped up against a wall. There were mildewed boxes of old parish records in one corner, and an open door that revealed a Victorian flush toilet and a basin, with only a cold tap, in the other. The infant opened his eyes and stared.
"We can put the food in here," said Silas. "It's cool, and the food will keep longer."
He reached into the box, pulled out a banana.
"And what would be that when it was at home?"
asked Mrs. Owens, eyeing the yellow and brown object suspiciously.
"It's a banana, a fruit from the tropics. I believe you peel off the outer covering," said Silas, "like so."
The child, Nobody, wriggled in Mrs. Owen's arms, and she let it down to the flagstones. It toddled rapidly to Silas, grasped his trouser leg, and held on. Mrs. Owens watched the boy eat.
"Banana," she said dubiously. "Never heard of them. Never. What's it taste like?"
"I've absolutely no idea," said Silas, who consumed only one food, and it was not bananas. "You could make up a bed in here for the boy, you know."
"I'll do no such thing. With Owens and me having a lovely little tomb over by the daffodil patch, plenty of room in there for a little one anyway,"
she added, concerned that Silas might think that she was rejecting his hospitality. "I wouldn't want the lad disturbing you."
"He wouldn't."
The boy was done with his banana. What he had not eaten was now smeared over himself. He beamed, messy and apple-cheeked.
"Nana,"
he said happily.
"What a clever little thing he is," said Mrs. Owens. "And such a mess he's made. Why, attend you, little wriggler."
And she picked the lumps of banana from his clothes and his hair.
And then, what do you think they'll decide?
I don't know.
I can't give him up, not after what I promised his mama.
Although I have been a great many things in my time, said Silas, I have never been a mother, and I do not plan to begin now. But I can leave this place.
Mrs. Owens said simply, I cannot. My bones are here, and so are Owens's. I'm never leaving.
It must be good, said Silas, to have somewhere that you belong, somewhere that's home.
There was nothing wistful in the way he said this. His voice was drier than deserts, and he said it as if he were simply stating something unarguable. Mrs. Owens did not argue.
Do you think we will have long to wait?
Not long, said Silas, but he was wrong about that.
Up in the amphitheater on the side of the hill, the debate continued. That it was the Owenses who had gotten involved in this nonsense, rather than some flibbertigibbet Johnny-come-latelys, counted for a lot, for the Owenses were respectable and respected. That Silas had volunteered to be the boy's guardian had weight. Silas was regarded with a certain wary awe by the graveyard folk, existing as he did on the borderland between their world and the world they had left. But still, a graveyard is not normally a democracy, and yet death is the great democracy, and each of the dead had a voice and an opinion as to whether the living child should be allowed to stay, and they were each determined to be heard that night. It was late autumn when the daybreak was low in coming. Although the sky was still dark, cars could now be heard starting up further down the hill, and as the living folk began to drive to work through the misty night black morning, the graveyard folk talked about the child that had come to them and what was to be done. 300 voices. 300 opinions. Nehemiah Trott, the poet from the tumbled northwestern side of the graveyard, had begun to declaim his thoughts on the matter, although what they were no person listening could have said, when something happened, something to silence each opinionated mouth, something unprecedented in the history of that graveyard. A huge white horse, of the kind that the people who know horses would call a gray, came ambling up the side of the hill. The pounding of its hooves could be heard before it was seen, along with the crashing it made as it pushed through the little bushes and thickets, through the brambles and the ivy and the gorse that had grown up on the side of the hill. The size of a shire horse it was, a full 19 hands or more. It was a horse that could have carried a knight in full armor into combat, but all it carried on its naked back was a woman, clothed from head to foot in gray. Her long skirt and her shawl might have been spun out of old cobwebs. Her face was serene and peaceful. They knew her, the graveyard folk, for each of us encounters the lady on the gray at the end of our days, and there is no forgetting her. The horse paused beside the obelisk. In the east, the sky was lightening gently, a pearlish pre-dawn luminescence that made the people of the graveyard uncomfortable and made them think about returning to their comfortable homes. Even so, not a one of them moved. They were watching the lady on the gray, each of them half excited, half scared. The dead are not superstitious, not as a rule, but they watched her as a Roman augur might have watched the sacred crow's circle, seeking wisdom, seeking a clue. And she spoke to them. In a voice like the chiming of 100 tiny silver bells, she only said, "The dead should have charity." And she smiled. The horse, which had been contentedly ripping up and masticating a clump of thick grass, stopped then. The lady touched the horse's neck, and it turned. It took several huge clattering steps, and then it was off the side of the hill and cantering across the sky. Its thunderous hooves became an early rumble of distant thunder, and in moments it was lost to sight. That, at least, was what the folk of the graveyard who had been on the hillside that night claimed had happened. The debate was over and ended, and, without so much as a show of hands, had been decided. The child called Nobody Owens would be given the freedom of the graveyard. Mother Slaughter and Josiah Worthington, Baronet, accompanied Mr. Owens to the crypt of the old chapel, and they told Mrs. Owens the news. She seemed unsurprised by the miracle. "That's right," she said. "Some of them don't have a ha'porth of sense in their heads, but she does. Of course she does." Before the sun rose on a thundering gray morning, the child was fast asleep in the Owens' fine little tomb. For Master Owens had dyed the prosperous head of the local cabinet-makers' guild,
and the cabinet makers had wanted to ensure that he was properly honored. Silas went out for one final journey before the sunrise. He found the tall house on the side of the hill, and he examined the three bodies he found there, and he studied the pattern of the knife wounds. When he was satisfied, he stepped out into the morning's dark, his head churning with unpleasant possibilities, and he returned to the graveyard, to the chapel spire, where he slept and waited out the days. In the little town at the bottom of the hill, the man, Jack, was getting increasingly angry. The night had been one that he had been looking forward to for so long, the culmination of months, of years of work. And the business of the evening had started so promisingly, three people down before any of them even had a chance to cry out. And then it had all gone so maddeningly wrong. Why on earth had he gone up the hill when the child had so obviously gone down the hill? By the time he had reached the bottom of the hill, the trail had gone cold. Someone must have found the child, taken it in, hidden it. There was no other explanation. A crack of thunder rang out, loud and sudden as a gunshot, and the rain began in earnest. The man, Jack, was methodical, and he began to plan his next move. The calls he would need to pay on certain of the townsfolk, people who would be his eyes and ears in the town. He did not need to tell the convocation he had failed. Anyway, he told himself, edging under a shop front as the morning rain came down like tears, he had not failed, not yet, not for years to come. There was plenty of time, time to tie up this last piece of unfinished business, time to cut the final thread. It was not until the police sirens sounded, and a first police car, then an ambulance, then an unmarked police car with a siren blaring sped past him on their way up the hill, that, reluctantly, the man Jack turned up the collar of his coat, put his head down, and walked off into the morning. His knife was in his pocket, safe and dry inside its sheath, protected from the misery of the elements.
So the toddler is safe. He has a name. What do you think will happen next? Share your predictions in the comments below and subscribe to our library YouTube channel to never miss an episode. And join us next Wednesday for a new episode of Tween Storytime with AHMFL.